Ladies and gentlemen, Jesse Ventura is a politician, actor, author, veteran who served three tours in Vietnam as a Navy SEAL. He's also a former professional wrestler, as you may know. But Jesse the Body Ventura, actually, I first came to be a fan through the movie Predator, in which he has an incredible role. He was more important than any of this, however, the 38th governor of Minnesota from 1999 to 2003. And he might make the case, or has made the case, there's not a whole lot of difference between professional wrestling and politics. And it's great to hear from that direct perspective. Someone who's got a real incredible resume in both fields. He hosted Conspiracy Theory on True TV and is the author of several books. And he is now the host of Off the Grid that comes to you from Mexico. He does what he is known best for, searching for the truth. No holds barred. Governor, thank you for joining us today.
Thanks, Adam. It's great to be here. But I do have to correct you a little bit. I had two deployments overseas, a 9-month and an 8-month. And it was at the end of the Vietnam War. In fact, my second deployment, they had already pulled our commitment out of Vietnam. And so we actually went to Subic Bay in the Philippines, my second deployment overseas, because that was way back in 72, 73, then.
And you took a lot of lessons from your experience. Can you tell us about what the moral of the story is and how it's applicable and influences you today?
Well, I think what I took back from my experience during the Vietnam era of time was that we were involved in another useless war that couldn't be won, that there was nothing the military could do to be able to really declare victory. And it was at that time that I've taken with me a very anti-war position because of the fact that I don't ever see anything accomplished by all these wars we get into.
Well, now a lot of people are really excited, having seen your record of doing that, having seen your record of telling it how it is and having exposed so many government lies. People are getting excited that there's the possibility of Jesse Ventura run for president in 2016. Can you give us your thoughts on that?
Well, I would say the possibility is close to slim to none because, again, I have to do it my way, and I won't do it with a political party, and the difficulty comes in getting ballot access. You know, I would require to get ballot access in all 50 states, and then there has to be a guarantee you'll be in the debates, because if you're not allowed in the debates, you stand no chance of winning. And if I were to run, I would run to win. I don't run just to make a statement, I run to win. But I really, you know, since I don't belong to a political party, I've got no infrastructure in place to do it. I really don't think that any run for the presidency is feasible. But then again, it's America, home of the brave, land of the free, and they'll surprise you every now and then.
Yes, and going into 2016, it seems like more and more Americans are looking for that. They would rather have an independent such as yourself and someone who is as fiercely independent as yourself committed to this race. Do you think there's a certain appeal to that, especially at this day?
Oh, there certainly is an appeal to it. And I let me put it to you this way. If I got the ballot access in all 50 states, and if I was allowed in the debates, there is a very good chance I would win.
Absolutely.
Because that's what happened in Minnesota. I was polling 10% at the primary. 8 weeks later, when I was allowed in the debates, I was the next governor of Minnesota. So the chances you could win are very good. But here's the problem. The problem is the Democrats and Republicans control the whole system, and they control who gets to debate and all that. If you notice, we've never had a third voice in a debate since 1992.
I was about to mention Ross Perot and the fact that he was able to pull this off, and that more recently even we saw Congressman Ron Paul as a grassroots candidate within the Republican Party really established an incredible base of support. And you have a lot of fans who are also fans of Ron Paul, who are very libertarian, who are looking at you right now as someone possibly to get behind in 2016 because they've seen that Rand Paul is not his father and would rather play the establishment games than speak to the message that we are so passionate about. But there's a lot of scrutiny as well coming on you for a couple of your positions from libertarians. I'd like to play a clip. This is an interview from Crossfire.
It's the law.
That's right.
How can these guys defy the law?
The law is passed. Both houses passed it.
And they're afraid it's going to work?
The Supreme Court said okay.
Yeah, the president signed it and the Supreme Court said it's fine.
Do you think they're afraid of it working?
Yes. And the thing they need to remember, this is Obama's legacy. So if it's so bad, why don't they hang him with
it? You don't think there is a contingency?
So it would appear to a lot of people casually listening to this that you're trying to defend Obamacare. What is your take on that and your justification of it based on it being passed by both houses of Congress and the Supreme and then approved by the Supreme Court?
Well, my position is really simple. I believe that in a country as rich as the United States, if you're sick, you should be able to go see a doctor. It's that simple. Now, how you want to get there is up to you on achieving that. But I think in a country like ours, you should be able to go to the doctor. Now, is Obamacare good and perfect? Absolutely not. But they've passed it. It's the law. It's reality. Now is the time, if it's there, attempt to fix it. I had this discussion earlier on my show. And people think in 1 year the government's going to get it right? I got news for them. In an economic thing like this, it's going to take at least 5 years and constant work upon it. And to sit and just tear it apart and throw it out, the baby with the bathwater? Well, look at it this way. Every congressman and senator has four choices of government-run health care. The military has government-run health care. If it's good enough for them, it ought to be good enough for us, or get rid of theirs too.
So is that your preferred scenario, that we get government out of healthcare entirely, get rid of it for the military and for Congress and make them buy it on their own on the free market? Or do you not have a problem with government in theory taking over or even having some significant role in the healthcare industry?
Well, let's remember this. Certain things in the private sector need to be regulated. We saw that in 2008 on Wall Street. When they took all the regulations off Wall Street and let that capitalism run amok out there, you saw what happened. Rape, pillage, and plunder. We all got robbed. We all lost wealth. And that was with pure... So you have to regulate even pure capitalism. You can't just let it run amok, or what happened in 2008 will be repeated again.
You don't think that any of those legitimate problems that you point out were caused by government intervention or regulation in the first place and the government support of the banking system through the Federal Reserve? And then just as a follow-up to that, are you saying that the answer to that is more government, that you prefer market that you prefer government regulation to market accountability?
Well, I prefer somebody regulating them from stealing. It's that simple, because if you take the handcuffs off Wall Street, there'll be nothing but pyramid games and all of that nonsense that will rob us blind. And the rich will get richer and the poor will get poorer.
Well, you understand that the power that Wall Street has largely comes from the Federal Reserve creating money out of thin air, that is what is stealing the savings and wealth of the American people. Why would you then turn to the group that is government, that is responsible for this massive theft that steals from us and through the IRS, and ask them to tell them to regulate Wall Street?
I'm not turning to them. But they are what they are. They exist and they're real. We got to deal with them. Now, are they the best thing available? Maybe not. But it's going to take a while to get away from that. I mean, they are entrenched. Do I agree with a national bank or like we have? Absolutely not. Our Constitution says there shall be no central bank. And until we can't just literally, they're too entrenched to destroy the central bank. We have to erode away from them and create independence from them the same way we got dependent upon them.
Well, I hope that it would start by turning away from government for these solutions when we have free market alternatives such as to regulation, providing market accountability, but that is taken from us when we turn to government, when we depend on government, and when we ask them to regulate, because, of course, they always regulate in favor of their sponsors and never the people. But I think this gets to...
What it all comes down to, Adam, is the system they've created there of bribery.
Yes.
You know, they've created a system where bribery is alive and well. If we do it in the private sector, we go to jail. We have to... And the way to solve that Like, even with the current Supreme Court thing where corporations can give money, they can buy the elections and all this, there's a way to even survive that. And that is to pass laws that every candidate is responsible for every dollar they receive when they run for office, and that they must fully disclose. That's where I come up with my laughable thing. We should make all candidates wear NASCAR suits.
Of course.
So that we can read who owns them. Like when you look at Jimmy Johnson, you know that Lowe's is the biggest sponsor of Jimmy Johnson, the great NASCAR racer. But open disclosure can help solve this problem of this underlying bribery that goes on. And everything comes back to that. We have a system based upon bribery. In the private sector, if you do it, you go to jail. In the public sector, it's alive and well. Pay them off, bribe them, and they give you what they want, what you want.
All right, Jesse, I really appreciate being able to get into these issues with you. And speaking to someone who is as frank as you are is always refreshing. But there was a question that you were asked on your show that this is from Aura.TV, where you have your producer Ricardo asking you the question, Ron Paul, Adam Kokesh, libertarianism, say it isn't so, Jesse. I've been listening to you for years, but didn't think you were sympathetic to.
I've been listening to you for years, but didn't think you were sympathetic to libertarians. You do realize that anarchy, as a libertarian's advocate, would result in a wet dream.
I like libertarians. I'm a libertarian myself. I just say that I'm a small L libertarian, not a capital L, because some libertarians I've met truly almost believe in anarchism, that there'll be no government whatsoever, there's no public ownership of anything. And I realize in a civilized society you must have government to a certain level to make it work. And so I like to refer to myself as a libertarian small L. I have great libertarian traditions of smaller government. I don't believe in the social program or the anti-social programs like the Republicans. You know, I believe in freedom. And we don't need the government regulating us on everything that we do in our lives. Government should have a role, but it needs to reduce its role drastically to what it is today.
Well, I think it's a very important distinction. A libertarian with a small L, meaning that you believe in freedom as a belief system rather than with a big L, as in belonging to a party or any particular doctrine. But I have to ask you then, how do you define freedom and how do you define government?
Well, how do I define freedom and government? Freedom is freedom to be able to do most everything you want to do as long as you don't inflict upon someone else.
Okay.
As long as your freedom doesn't cross over and infringe upon somebody else's freedom.
Right.
That's where we need government. That's where government comes into the equation, when one person's freedom inflicts upon another person's. Then we have to have some mechanism to decide who's inflicting upon who.
Okay.
But other, you know, so I guess that's the simplest way I can answer the difference between, you know, libertarian and government and all of that.
No, that's a very important distinction. But the way that you define government as that which steps in at that point of conflict, it doesn't really sum it up. I mean, a government is a territorial monopoly that within that territory claims a monopoly on the initiation of force, and as you point out, is essential in settling disputes. But if you believe in the market, if you believe in freedom, then the existence of that government founded on taxation is fundamentally incompatible with your definition of freedom. So I have to ask then, is taxation theft?
Is taxation theft? No. No, I don't believe that it is fully. I believe, though, that the income tax is.
Well, let me ask you then, what is theft?
Income tax, I don't think we should have it.
Well, what is theft? Hold on, what is
wealth is based upon how much you earn. Wealth is more based on what you spend, not what you earn.
Okay, well, I'd really like.
I've always advocated for a national sales tax to fund the government if you're going to have it. Because then it's going to be the same rate for everybody that buys in. When you buy something, you pay a certain sales tax that helps to operate the government. And if the government can't survive off a percentage of the gross national product, then it's time to rip this government apart and create a new one.
Well, theft is taking something that you don't own. And when you say that you advocate for a sales tax, you're basically saying that if you buy something at a point of sale, then you have to give a portion of that to the government. And the government collects that by applying the threat of force. If you were to sell something when there's a sales tax.
I understand where you're coming from. I guess if you want to have no government, then good luck, because you're going to have chaos, I believe.
I think what we have is chaos because of government.
That we can have life in a civilized society without some form of government. There has to be some form of government, and that form of government has to be paid somehow. That doesn't exist without some type of payment. And how you want to determine to pay and implement a form of government in a civilized society is your call. But I'm not going to buy into the fact that no government will work. I don't believe that.
Well, government in itself is the violation of this perfect order of freedom. Government itself is the source of all the chaos, as you and your esteemed works so point out, that all of the problems that come from government in your books, you know, the documents that government doesn't want you to see, all of these things.
Let me throw this in then. If you're not going to have government, then who solves crime? When someone goes out and commits armed robbery, then we have private vigilantes that ride around and determine who's guilty.
Well, actually, that's a very good.
See, there's got to be some semblance to order, and you have to pay for that.
Absolutely.
Well, comes with a price tag.
For your last part, absolutely. But if I may actually address your question here, and it's a very common objection to libertarianism that you can't have the free market provide these things. But the reality is that when you have the government provide these things, when you have the government provide dispute resolution services and public safety services, you get the police state that you have today. And it's not a problem with runaway government. It is inherent to the nature of government, because you're saying we're going to empower the government to have all the guns. We're going to empower them to be the ones that are the ones that get to point them at peaceful people. Yes, citizens can be armed, sure, but the government gets to use violence against people acting peacefully. That is to collect taxes. They get to threaten force to pay for these things. So you have an institution that is based on coercion and violence that gets to set its own salaries, determine its own budget,
right.
And then take the money from the people.
I need you to educate me, and we can't do it here. You tell me how all of this works without government.
Send
me a thing and tell us we're going to abolish the existence of government. We will never, ever have it again. And please explain to me how the society will then function without it.
Well, I can do it in just a minute, sir, if you'll listen. Because government is force by definition. It is the initiation of force in a given geographical area. It is a monopoly on force that is imposed by a gang of thugs who try to impose their will and come up with excuses through the political process. When you're really libertarian, if you really believe in freedom and you understand, as you define it, sir, that freedom is based on respect for the rights of others, that it is essentially universal nonviolence, a universally nonviolent society is the definition of a free society. And if you impose an organization based on violating that, namely government, you end up with all of the predictable consequences that we have today. And it might be at present that we can't see how we are going to solve these problems of providing for the public safety or building roads without coercion.
By getting rid of the government, everyone will stay in line and everyone will behave.
Well, if you can't trust people with power, if you can't trust people with the freedom to behave, how can you trust them with the power to rule over other people? And the question, the question is based on a false premise.
But like I said, I got to see it in action. You got to prove it to me that you can remove government, and that we as human beings will all respect each other, and we won't transgress against
each
other.
Yes, here's the proof right here, sir.
And that we'll all be able to handle it in our own way. I would love to see that. I would love to see an example of it.
The examples are all around us, sir, and the proof is throughout the world. When you see someone choosing to commit an act of violence against a fellow human being, government almost never is able to step in. Police show up afterwards and file reports and write reports and occasionally catch criminals. But more importantly, they institutionalize criminal behavior in government, as I know you're very familiar with. There is not a single person who, in making a decision whether or or not to commit a crime against another person that they know they can get away with says, well, geez, is government going to come in and stop me if I mug this person? Is there going to be a cop standing between me and this other person? It doesn't work that way. Most human beings already behave this way. They respect the rights of others. It is only government that is the major aberration in society. And for the individual actors who are legitimate bad actors, we can find the ways to deal with them without turning to other criminals, namely government, in order to deal with that. We can come together peacefully through market mechanisms to achieve those things.
How do we find that way? Explain that way that we find. Who's in charge? Who is in charge to make that decision?
I'm in charge of myself as an individual, and I get to choose what services I support with my money. I don't get to force anybody else into this. It is morally wrong if you see someone committing a crime to say, well, we have to do something about it, therefore I'm going to steal from a bunch of other people through government in order to hire someone to go after them. You can persuade them, you can bring them into it through respect for their freedom, but it makes you just as much a criminal as the criminal you're trying to stop when you say, well, let's turn to government and an institution based on crime in order to achieve that.
Well, I think you and I will differ slightly on that, because I just believe the population is too large, there's too many people out there to put it in the hands of every basic individual to behave correctly. They're not going to do it. And somebody has to, I just don't see, I think it's a utopian viewpoint to believe that we can all live without some type of, in a civilized society. I just can't, you're going to have to educate me on it.
Well, I actually think it's quite utopian to think we can have a government and expect peace, that we can entrust all the power and put all the guns in the hands of a limited group of people and some capital and say, now please limit yourself, limit your size. And I think it's really sad
I'm not saying that. You're putting words in my mouth on that one. I'm not saying that.
Well, what is you're advocating for a limited government that has the power to tax, and you're hoping that it's going to be able to limit itself. Is that incorrect?
You're advocating for no government at all, and you say it will work. There will be no government. We will all just make up our own minds and do our own collective thinking, and we'll all work out our own problems. Hey, if you can do it, that's wonderful. Good luck.
Well, I think if anything, we see how government is exactly not working. And it's really sad that a lot of people have been convinced that human nature is so bad that we need government, that we've been convinced to be so afraid of each other that we need this institution. I would hope, especially someone with your background and your vast body of knowledge and your incredible experience, would be able to see that this is just another piece of government propaganda to say that you're dependent on them. And it's exactly the same as Obamacare or with any other government service. Government says, if it wasn't for us, you couldn't do this, you couldn't build the roads. And people say, well, we need government, and then we accept all the consequences.
I'm not dependent on anyone. But again, like when I was governor of Minnesota and I started talking about transportation issues, the libertarians booed me. And I said, you don't think there should be any type of public transportation? No. I said, well, how'd you get here today? Well, we drove on the highways. What do you think that is? And if you're going to rely on privatization of everything, you're going to have a toll every 500 feet. Because everyone's going to want to make money on their piece of the land, and there won't be any public domain, no public government ownership for the good of all. Everything will be privately owned, and therefore I can charge anything I want to cross my privately owned land. I really don't think our economy will do very well under those conditions.
Oh, well, let me ask you a broader question about policy then. Where do you draw the line as to what is and is not an appropriate function of government?
Well, you draw the line on how people vote on it and the laws that they elect their officials to vote in. See, ultimately, all the blame of government comes back to us because we're not vigilant, because we don't stay on our elected officials, and that we don't pay attention. But if we're vigilant and pay attention, the simple fact is we're the boss, because our money pays for government to function. We have every right to know what our money's paying for. So therefore, we've lost sight of the fact we're the boss and they work for us. They've made us believe that somehow we have to kowtow to them and that they are the bosses. And that's essentially, I think, that's what's gone sour in today's day and age, is our forgetting to believe that we are the boss and they work for us.
Well, you know, there's this alternative system where you get to be the boss all the time, where you get to, you know, exert your preference with every decision.
How can you have a world of all bosses?
When every human being asserts their right to be free.
You're giving me this utopian thing where all of us will be our own individual boss. Well, I got
is that utopian? Is that utopian?
Conflict of interest. Heads are going to
sure, butt. Sure, but is it utopian?
To do with government.
Wait. You're saying that it's utopian now, and maybe this is getting to the crux of things in terms of our views of human nature. You're saying that it's utopian for every human being to be the boss, to be free, to be the alpha of their own lives?
No, I'm saying that you're going to have conflict of interest because if we're all the boss. If every one of us is our own boss, what happens when two bosses have a difference of opinion?
Well, how is it settled today?
We're all bosses now.
Sure.
We're all bosses.
Yeah,
so
and as long as we respect that, that's the point. That's what we're working towards.
My man here, Abraham, he and I have a difference of opinion and we're both bosses. How do we resolve that difference when we're both bosses?
Peacefully, cooperatively, and if you disagree, you walk away without violating their right as the boss of their life.
How do you have a business? How do you have a business where there's workers and the boss?
You're saying how do we have? Are you saying how do we have businesses without government?
The workers and the boss is in charge. The workers
sure.
have to do what the boss says.
Well, in an arrangement like that, the worker is the boss of themselves, and they voluntarily enter into an employment agreement in which they are exchanging labor as directed by the demands of the person paying for it for money as supplied by the employer. It's a pretty simple free market concept. You don't need the government for that.
But why do you have to do what he says? After all, you're individual and you're your own boss.
You don't. You
why
can
you
walk away at any time.
Money,
yes.
He can buy you off with bribery and you'll do what he wants simply because he pays you?
No, that's a free market exchange of value. You can walk away at any time. You are being paid for your labor. That's the foundation of the free market, is that we are able to exchange what we own, ourselves, our labor, for money.
And how does one survive at that if you are your own boss and you never take an order? So therefore, who's going to hire you when you're going to do it your way or the highway, and no one's going to lord over you and tell you what to do because you have the freedom to walk away?
Well, just because...
How are you going to survive off that?
Okay, well, you're really conflating things here, because just because you're your own boss as an employer or as an employee and you're able to say, I can walk away at any time, doesn't mean you're not going to take orders in terms of an order for where you direct your labor. And if a boss says you're going to do this or I'm not going to pay you, that's just how the free market works. That's how lots of companies work. You've run businesses that way, and it doesn't mean that you have any particular violent or forceful or coercive control over your employees. I hope your producer in the room right now is not being held hostage at gunpoint. I hope you have a voluntary relationship with him and you pay him for his labor.
I'll tell you what, money corrupts and people will do a lot of things for money. So if you're going to rely on honesty and money, again, I think you're talking utopia here.
Well, honesty and money, yes, very important issues for government that it clearly subverts. So you think it's utopian to actually respect the fact that everybody can be a free, beautiful, independent human being?
You put a lot of words in my mouth.
Well, I'm asking,
a realist.
Sir.
I understand what I live in on a day-to-day basis, and I'm realistic about it. And I understand, having been in government, that getting them to change takes years sometimes because it's so big.
Absolutely.
And so bureaucratic, and there's so many of us. And to simply say, okay, we're throwing government out now, there won't be any government left in the world today, and everyone's their own boss, and you can do what you please? I gotta wait, can I sit back somewhere and watch all this come to fruition and just observe it all and see how it all comes out?
Well, actually, sir, I think it's already happening, and in a large part thanks to you and your incredible work of waking people up to the nature of government. A lot of people have realized that relationships based on peaceful cooperation, as you describe in your definition of freedom, are superior to ones based on coercion, and that we should by moral principle.
But that's going to take a long time, isn't it, to wean ourselves off government?
Absolutely.
We can't do it
years.
In a week or a month.
No, years. I believe it would take several years at least.
Dozens of years to work in that direction. Otherwise, it'll be like shock treatment. Everyone's in charge of themselves, and there's no police anymore. And there's nobody, you know, because we're all going to obey and do what's right for society. I just don't buy into that right now because I don't think we're capable of it.
Well, I'm sorry, sir. As much as I respect your work, it is hard to hear you make a statement that seems to be based on the premise that the police force or government police forces actually prevent crimes or have an effect for that more than they commit them.
I have not said that at all. Please do not put words in my mouth. I haven't said that. I've just said that in order to change a society that's been in place for thousands of years, which is called government, and you're going to eliminate government, that's not going to happen overnight. It's taken thousands of years to get where it's at, and to destruct it that quickly overnight and expect human nature to survive and do it the right way?
Well,
like I said, I got to sit back and don't put words in my mouth,
sir,
and
absolutely.
Say, oh, Jesse Ventura's betrayed the cause.
Well, no, I appreciate that, but
in a civilized society, there has to be some form of organization that oversees it.
Well,
because
sir,
because if you leave it all to us, it's whoever's got the biggest handguns going to be in charge.
Well, I appreciate your correction there, but I could say the same thing, that you seem to have presumed something about my position in advocating for an immediate transition. No, this is an ideal to be strived for, but the more people wake up to this, the more people accept your definition of freedom, the more likely we are to see this transition to reach this critical mass. And I want to commend you for helping people wake up to this. I would just hope that you would really consider these issues in terms of what is government, what is the free market, and what is the possibility of people taking the lessons learned from your incredible work to realize true freedom, in which we are all respected, as you say, as bosses, but as the alphas of our own lives, as free, beautiful, independent human beings, and have our rights respected in society, and then we can build a society based on those values. I really appreciate the conversation, and I wish we had more time today, and I love being able to have a conversation with someone of your credibility and your experience, and I you know, in the last time we spoke, we talked about our similar combat experience, although I should say mine is really insignificant compared to yours. And I'm very grateful that there are people like you in this fight now who have that same military experience and bring it to a more important fight against government.
And let me add, I'm behind you 100%. I just think it's got to be taken. You know, you're talking with people that have been entrenched in a system for a long, long time. And in order to move that system the way we got to do it, everyone wishes you could do it quick, but it's going to take a long, long time to succeed. But keep up the good work, man. That's what makes America great, is we can exchange ideas and work for the betterment of all of us. I'm all for less government, but I just believe that the way you get less government will have to be a bit slower, because I don't think the people of the United States are capable of it, of doing it that quickly, that you're going to have to do it, excuse the term, a little bit in baby steps, in my opinion, on a certain aspects of it.
Well, maybe we're closer than it may seem, but I definitely appreciate that. I appreciate the conversation. If you would take
Thanks.
A minute, sir, tell us about what you're working on now. What's the status with Off the Grid, and you know, why are you in Mexico?
Well, I'm down here because I hate cold weather. To be perfectly honest, I'm born and raised in Minneapolis, Minnesota, and I was a high school swimmer, so I never did anything in the winter. I despise snow. I don't like cold weather, so that's why I live here. We're doing Off the Grid. Of course, it's on every Tuesday through Friday on Aura.tv at 3 p.m. Eastern. It's my dream job because I get to sound off on anything that I want with no, as you say, no FCC regulations on this
yep.
one, baby. There's no government sitting over me. And I agree, you know, we agree more than we disagree by far.
Absolutely.
And so I'll just keep pumping out what I believe is the truth. And it's up to the American people to decipher and determine who they want to listen to and what way they want to go.
And I think we'd both be confident in saying that if more Americans were in on this level of conversation, we'd be a lot better off. Thank you so much for joining us today, sir.
Absolutely, we will be. And we'll find the happy median, and we'll find something we can all live with. Have a good one.
Ricardo from Alameda, California says, Ron Paul, Adam Kokesh, libertarianism? Say it isn't so, Jesse. I've been listening to you for years, but didn't think you were sympathetic to libertarians. You do realize that anarchy, as the libertarians advocate, would result in a wet dream scenario for corporatocracy, right? Where do you stand on libertarianism, Jesse? Please don't break my heart.
Well, I'm not gonna break your heart. I'm gonna tell you the truth. Libertarianism means liberal. I don't know where everybody got this thought that being a libertarian means you're a conservative, because you're not. Libertarian simply means I'm fiscally conservative and I'm socially liberal. When it comes to government and the spending of money in government, I'm fiscally conservative. I want small government. I want efficient government, and I want it like that. On the social issues, I'm as liberal as you can get. I don't care. Gay marriage is fine. End the war on drugs. But no, I'm not for anarchy. There is a role for government. Our government takes too big of a role in our lives, and we need to accept some of that responsibility ourselves.
Don't forget to like, share, and please subscribe to this channel.
You, as a free, beautiful, independent human being with inalienable rights, own yourself.
You just exposed yourself. I saw you.